Grab your Bibles and join me in Ephesians chapter 1, please. Ephesians chapter 1. You can see me over the pulpit today, can't you? This is a real stool. If I can get situated on it. Somebody described it as a high chair. We won't go there. All right. Ephesians chapter 1. We started a study through the book of Ephesians weeks and weeks and weeks ago before we had some health hiccups going on. But now we're coming back again. Hopefully last week was a help in reminding you of where we've been, the stage that we set several weeks ago, what we're looking at in the book of Ephesians, what Paul was teaching this church, and what we have to gain from it as well. And so came back to it last week, and we continue on this week as well. Let me have a word of prayer to get us started. And then we'll kind of reach back to last week, pull it forward, and keep going even further this week together. So join me in a word of prayer, please. Well, Father, we're glad for music that reminds us of the Godhead, the Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. We're so thankful that you have revealed yourself in all three persons, that your scripture tells us about each person of the Godhead, what you are in your essence, that you are one, each of you one with the other, but individual persons, distinct, but at the same time unified in all that you have always been doing and always will be doing, even when it comes to the redemption of your people, each person involved in that. And so thank you for music that reminds us, but then also music that gives us a channel to praise you for who you are and for what you have done, which moves us toward what we're talking about again this morning here in Paul's letter, that is the theme, to the praise of the glory of God, to the praise of the glory of your grace. And so I pray that as we go into this section of Scripture this morning, that you would work as only you can. We need your help. Every person in this room needs what we're going to hear this morning, whether believing or unbelieving. We need the truth. We are surrounded by lying voices. Voices that come from within, voices from the outside, all trying to turn us away from you, trying to get us to think that you're not real, or even if you are real, you don't care, or you're not powerful, or you're something other than what you say you are. So we need the truth desperately. Only the truth can set us free from sin and death. So, as we get into your word this morning, I pray that your Holy Spirit will work with power in every heart, just as we need. He knows what we each need. I don't know, but he knows what we each need, and he is able to work that way. So we pray that way. And I pray that you will keep us free from distractions. We know that's a subtle tool of the enemy. We know that that's what our own flesh wants to try to do this morning as well. So I pray that you will protect us from all distractions so that we can listen, focus, hear with our ears, but also concentrate and understand in our minds and our hearts. And come away from here this morning with a much greater view than we've ever had before, higher than before. Behold our God. We want to see you as you are, as you present yourself, because we want to be enamored with you and your Son only. That's where our joy comes from. That's where you get your glory. So, Father, you make that happen as we're in the Word this morning. We give you all the praise for what you do. In Christ's name, amen. So our question has been, what is a true church? What is a true church? Are you part of one? How do you know? What measurement do you use to judge a church? Good one, bad one? On track, off track? Need to leave now, need to go there? What measurement do you use? Do you go by its name? Churches these days are changing their names like we change our clothes every day, trying to give a new impression to the public that we're not what you think we are, we're not what we used to be, we're something new, we're something better. Do you measure a church and its successfulness or its legitimacy by the name of the church? Or maybe the appearance of the facilities? What's the building look like? Outside, inside, is it more contemporary or is it old and musty? You go by that? Maybe the style of preaching, or the style and the quality of the music, or maybe the programs and activities that are going on at that church all the time. Or maybe the atmosphere of the worship service. What's it like when the people meet together? Is there a feeling that the Holy Spirit is there and people are excited and something's going on or not? Do you judge by the number of people who attend a worship service at a particular church? Or the type of people who attend the worship service at a local church? Well, all of those things probably give a pretty good checklist of a lot of church seekers today. If you were to interview people who are looking around for different churches, you'd probably hear some of those things. That's what they're looking for. That's what's important to them. But sadly, none of those are characteristics of what God considers to be a true church. We saw many, many weeks ago, as we kind of outlined the book of Ephesians, a true church is defined by what it is and what it does, both of which are diametrically opposed to most human expectations, what it is and what it does. The Apostle Paul is giving us a really good look at both of those characteristics, what a true church is and what a true church does. He's giving us a good look at both of those by telling the Ephesians what they are in chapters 1 through 3. That's a pretty good summary of chapters 1 through 3. What is the local church? What are they? And then in chapters 4 through 6, Paul's going to go on to show them what they should be doing. We're going to get to that eventually, maybe years from now, who knows. Well, what are they? What is this church? What is a true church? Well, let me put up here on the screen again for you very quickly what we've seen already. A true church is a congregation of saints. It's a group of individual people who are being set apart by God in a lot of different ways. But what Paul is bringing out in his letter here is how they are set apart with and through certain spiritual blessings. We've covered several of those already. Here they are. Election. After that, we saw in verse 5 that we are predestined to adoption as sons of God. Another blessing is the blessing of redemption, being set free from our slavery to sin and from our record of sin. Another blessing is the blessing of illumination, the mystery through all the ages, things, something prophets longed to understand as they talked about it, but didn't understand what they were talking about. Now the saints have been given this mystery revealed in the form of illumination. We talked about this incredible inheritance that awaits those who are God's people, the saints. That inheritance being Christ himself. And then last week, we talked about another blessing, which is the blessing of faith. You say, faith? Yes, faith. Oh, we exercise faith. We abandon all hope and everything else for our righteousness and trust in Christ alone and what he did to make us righteous. But we only do that. We only believe because God first, prior, gave us the faith to do so. Now, all of those blessings up here on the screen and all the rest that we're going to talk about in weeks to come, all of them come with what you kind of consider a string attached, right? You know what I mean by that? They're ours because the Father connected us inseparably to Christ before time. He placed us in Christ. In other places, the Word of God talks about him giving us to Christ. And so the result of that is the Father views and treats us as he views and treats Christ. So what the Father promised Christ, he's promised to us in Christ. What Christ gives to the Father, it's as if we're giving it to the Father in Christ. What Christ earned, it's as if we earned it in Christ. What the Father gives to Christ, he gives to us. How the Father feels about Christ, he feels about us in Christ. You get it? That union with Christ causes the Father to bless us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. That's the string attached. And folks, that's what a true church is. It's not all that a true church is, but that is what a true church is. It is a group of people set apart by the Father, placing them in Christ and giving them these gifts by virtue of their union with Christ. Now, That's a good list so far, but we haven't exhausted it yet. There are several more. We've got one to talk about this morning, another one. And this one, just like the rest, ought to impact us both emotionally and practically. It ought to affect how we feel, and it ought to affect what we do as those who are receiving these blessings. Now, before we get to it, let me just say this. Last week, we saw a direct link between the last two blessings that we had talked about. So the Father planned an eternal inheritance for the saints. And what was his ultimate reason for giving that inheritance? Well, he said it in verse 12. Look back there if you will. That we who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of his glory. Paul and those other Jews back in and around Jerusalem who first came to realize that this Jesus of Nazareth is the Messiah, why did God give them that faith and open their eyes to be able to see that and understand that and embrace Jesus Christ? So that they would be to the praise of his glory. Not just the Jewish people, but even we Gentiles who have come later. That's the reason, the ultimate reason for this inheritance, for Christ to be praised for his glory. Well, how will that happen? It happens by the Father giving faith to his chosen people. That causes us to see and hate our wickedness. It causes us to trust desperately in the life of Jesus to make things right for us. Then, when we inherit him, when we get to be with him, how do we respond? Oh, we're so infatuated with him. We can't contain our joy over him and our gratitude to him. And for all of eternity in his presence, we then praise him for his glory. We praise him for the glory of God's grace through him. That's how God's ultimate purpose is accomplished through this blessing, this gift of faith. And that's the link between verses 11 and 12. That's the link between our inheritance and our faith. Now, Paul goes further and does the same thing again. We're now going to see him make a direct link between God's gift of faith and this next blessing. What's the blessing? Look at verses 13 and 14. We saw verse 13 last week, but we got to reach back to it again to go forward. Verse 13, in him, in Christ, you also trusted, you Gentile Ephesian believers, you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. What's the next blessing? Here it is on the screen. Let's just call it sealing. Because that's the word that Paul used here. Verse 13, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. Now, you remember the closing last week? Can you remember that far back? I can't remember 5 minutes ago, so maybe you can't. But as we wrap things up last week, I kind of left you, or left some of you at least, with an exhortation. It came from Luke chapter 11. That's one of the places where the gospel writers record it, but it was Christ talking to his disciples and some other people as well. And Christ said, basically, if you see that you have a spiritual need, ask, seek, knock. And what will the Father give to you? Christ said, the Holy Spirit. Why? Why is that his answer to people who go to him with a spiritual need, knocking, seeking, asking? And he gives the Holy Spirit as his answer. Why? What's so valuable about that particular gift? Why not something else? Why not something more? Why not something different? Why the Holy Spirit? Well, Paul is telling us here in his letter. He's answering that question for us. So the Father gives the gift of faith to the saint. The saint trusts in Christ. The saint starts depending fully on Christ's life and death for his salvation. And then having believed, having trusted in Christ, the Father immediately seals him with the Spirit. Our question is, what does that sealing do for the believer? Well, our first hint is in how Paul describes the Holy Spirit in verse 13. Did you notice that? You were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. Not just the Holy Spirit of promise. Now, it is not unusual for the Holy Spirit to get descriptive words along with his name. Jesus did it, right? You remember when he was in the upper room with his disciples not long before he went out to the garden and then was arrested after that, and he was starting to tell them that he was leaving, and you remember how that conversation went. They were so upset, and rightly so. And you remember how he tried to comfort them. He comforted them by telling them that when he left, someone else was going to come in his place. Who? The Holy Spirit of truth. He didn't say the Holy Spirit of promise. He was making a promise, but he described him as the Holy Spirit of truth, or the Spirit of truth. What did he mean by that? He meant the Holy Spirit is the one who delivers God's truth to his messengers and to his people. So if you look back to the Old Testament and the prophets that were sent to the people of Israel, the messages which came to those prophets to the nation of Israel originated where? The Holy Spirit. God gave his truth to the Holy Spirit. He gave it to the prophets to deliver to their people. What Jesus is promising to his disciples in John chapter 13 and 14 and 15, or 14, 15, 16, is that the same thing is going to happen with these men as apostles of Jesus Christ. Christ is going to send his truth for his people, but he's going to do it through those apostles. And so what you find is the Holy Spirit is both the inspirer of truth and the illuminator of truth, right? He gives and he gives understanding of God's truth. He is the Spirit of truth. Paul also has given another label to the Holy Spirit. If you can run the wheels in your mind for a second, it won't take you long to get there. But in Romans chapter 8, Paul refers to the Holy Spirit as the Spirit of what? Adoption, right? He is the Spirit of adoption. What he means is the Spirit is the one who works in our hearts, the hearts of the saints, to make us feel adopted. It's not just that there's a matter of fact that we are, but the Holy Spirit's the one who makes us feel adopted. He convinces us that it has taken place. He makes us believe that we are now sons of God. He's also the one that creates this love inside of us for our new Heavenly Father, our Daddy. And he's the one then that leads us where our daddy wants us to go. He's the Spirit of adoption, Spirit of truth. Well, now here, Ephesians chapter 1, to these Ephesians saints, Paul gives another label to the Holy Spirit. And he calls him the Spirit of promise. So what does that role look like for the Holy Spirit? And what's it got to do with these blessings that the Father has planned and organized and carried out and given to all of those who are his people? Well, looking back at each blessing again, I want to make an observation for us to move us a little bit further in these thoughts. Let me walk you through these once again. First of all, think about our election. That is something that was done before anything was ever created. It was a choice made by God, done, finished, not partially. Not, well, I'm going to make a little bit of the choice now and then I'll add to it later. No, this blessing, this gift of election was ours before God ever created a thing. Done, finished, fully realized, okay? Go to the next one on the list, adoption. That too is something that was predestined before we were ever chosen. Before he ever picked the ones who were going to be adopted, he planned that they would be adopted. And then he sent Christ to meet all of the conditions to make us fit for that adoption. And then when we trusted in Jesus Christ, it was made effective in our lives spiritually. At that point, we became as much the sons of God as we will ever be the sons of God. It's not like, okay, well, you get part of your sonship now. And maybe you've got a probationary sonship now, and then later on I'm going to give you the rest of your sonship, and I'm going to bring you more fully into the family of God. No. When we believed, we were adopted into the family of God. And so that's another one, another blessing of God that's been done. It's been fully realized as well. Now, I want you to skip one and go to illumination. So as I said a second ago, God, through his apostles, has revealed now what he had kept hidden for generation after generation after generation. He has now revealed to us what he's been doing all along. What's that? Jews and Gentiles, redeemed, reconciled, glorified, and then gathered to Christ for all eternity. We're not waiting for that revelation. It's been made. It's been put out there through the Apostle Paul and other apostles. We now have that revelation. We have that truth, and we have that understanding of what God has been doing all along but wasn't explaining all along. Now we know it. So illumination is another one of these blessings that have been fully realized in our lives as the saints. Now skip to the last one, faith. Once again, we've been given all the faith that God wants us to have. And with that faith, we are trusting fully and only in Christ to make us righteous. Nothing's going to change about that. We're never going to get more faith. It might be strengthened at times for particular times of need, but we're never going to have faith added to faith as time goes on. He's given us all the faith that he plans for us to have. And so those blessings, election, adoption, illumination, faith, those are blessings that are fully realized. They've been given and they've been received in full measure. There's nothing lacking. There's nothing left out with those blessings. But what about the two that I skipped on the list? Do you notice? Redemption and that inheritance. We didn't talk about those. Why did I skip them? Well, in your studies, in your reading, in listening to preaching, have you ever heard of the already, not yet feature of God's work? Already, not yet. That sounds weird, doesn't it? A lot of pastors talk about it. You'll see commentators and scholars writing about it as they try to explain what God is doing throughout time. And what they mean by that is that there are some gifts of God which he has given to us partly already, but not fully yet. Hear it? Already, not yet. Some blessings he has given us partly already, but not fully yet. Two of those are on our list. I just mentioned them to you. Look back with me to verse 7, if you will, very quickly. Chapter 1, verse 7. And what does Paul say? He says, in him, in Christ, we have redemption. We have it. Paul's language is, we are having it right now. We're not waiting for it. It's not just a promise. It is something that has been given and it has been received. And we know how that happened, right? The Father put down the ransom price. What was that? The blood of Christ. The death of his Son. And he did that to purchase us and set us free from our slavery to sin and also from the record of our sins. Remember, as Christ died on that cross, the record of our sins was nailed to the cross with him, and as he died, that record was erased. And so we've received forgiveness of sins, which is a part of this word redemption that we're talking about. Now, our question is, do we have that redemption already? And the answer is, sure. Yes, definitely. Again, our record of sins has been erased when Christ died on the cross, and we are no longer obligated to serve sin. Sin is no longer our master. Sin no longer owns us. There's no longer a relationship where sin calls and we have to come running. We've been redeemed. We're free from the charges. We are free from the obligation. But are we fully redeemed yet? Ever thought about that? Are we fully redeemed? The answer to that is no. We still choose to serve sin sometimes. We don't have to. We're not obligated to. We don't owe it to sin, but sometimes sin comes calling and we respond. And we do the will of sin, don't we? The connection is not fully broken yet. We are not completely free from sin's power and sin's influence over us. Redemption. Already, not yet. Now look at verse 11. Let me give you another example, okay? Verse 11, Paul says, in him, that is in Christ, also we have obtained an inheritance. It's happened. We have obtained it. It's been given to us. It's ours already. But are we enjoying that inheritance yet? I mean, in its full sense? And the answer is no, we're not. It's kind of like the father who makes a will. He goes to the attorney. He's got all these notes written out, and he lays out to the attorney, when he dies, this is exactly what he wants to go to each of his children. Maybe they divide it up equally. Maybe it's particular things to particular kids. Whatever. The father makes it clear exactly how his assets are to be distributed to his children. And as soon as he signs it, and a witness signs it, and the attorney notarizes it, it's done. No one can change it except for him. No one can stop it from being carried out. It's certain. But what else is true? Those children don't get those assets until he dies. It's certain. It's guaranteed that they're going to get them, but they don't have them yet. Well, similarly, our inheritance of Christ is certain. It has been willed by the Father. It is guaranteed, and nothing can change that. Nothing can stop us from receiving that. But we're not with Christ yet, are we? We're not in His presence bodily, glorified, so that we can enjoy Him fully and He can enjoy us in the state that He deserves to enjoy us. So there's this already not yet quality about those two blessings, both redemption and the inheritance. We have them partly already, but not fully yet. So how can we be sure the yet is going to come? How can we be positive that this thing, these things, this completed redemption and this inheritance of Jesus Christ that God has promised to us, how can we be absolutely sure it's going to happen? We're going to get them. How can we be sure? Well, if I let you answer right now, you come up with several reasons. You would probably tell me, well, it's because the Father chose to do it. The Father planned to give them to us, and whatever He purposes, He does. Isaiah chapter 46 makes that very clear, one of my favorite passages of Scripture. Whatever God plans to do, He does. No one can stop it. And so, if He has planned to give us the rest of those two blessings, nothing can stop it. It's going to happen. We also know the Father sent His Son to secure those blessings for us. Wednesday nights, we've been talking about the servant songs in the book of Isaiah, and it's very, 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 chapter 42, I think, and 49, both of those places, the Father is talking about sending the Son to go to the dungeon and set free the prisoners who have been living behind the gates and in darkness. And the Son is gone as the servant of the Father to set free those prisoners. We know what? Did the servant fail in that? Absolutely not. The servant was 100% successful in the role that the Father gave him to do. And so this work of redemption is going to happen. This inheritance that needed to be earned for God's people, it has happened. And so it will come someday in the future. We also realize that the Father promised these things to us in Christ, and this God is a God who cannot lie. The book of Hebrews makes that clear. The book of Titus makes that clear. God cannot lie. So if He tells you it's coming, it is coming. But it's like all of those reasons, all of those supports aren't enough for the Father to give us the confidence that He wants us to have. And so here, through the Apostle Paul to the church at Ephesus, the Father adds to our confidence in these blessings. Look at verse 14 again, if you will. Or verse 13, I'm sorry. Halfway through, he says, "In whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise." There it is again. He sealed us with the Holy Spirit of promise. Now, what does that mean? What is this work? What is this action? The Father, through the Holy Spirit, sealing His people for the promises that are still out in the future. Well, this word sealing is not something that's familiar to us in our culture today. I doubt that any of you sealed anything this past week like this is picturing. And so let me give you the picture. You probably already know this. So an official, or maybe a king, would send a package with an object in the package. He would close the package and close down the flap on the package just to make an envelope like we know of it today. And closing that flap on the back of that package, he then took and dripped some wax right down on that flap. And when he got enough wax there in a circle and it was just starting to cool and harden, he would take his own personal signet ring and he would push it down into that wax. And that's the seal. That was his own personal seal. And it was put on there to send a very clear message to everyone. Everyone who would come across that package, everyone who would handle that package, everyone who would see that passage going by, that seal sent a very, very clear message. That seal was a mark of authenticity. When someone saw that seal, they said, oh, yeah, that came from the king. No one else has that signet ring. No one else can make that seal. So this is authentic. It came from the king. It sent a message of ownership, too. Whatever was in that package was the king's. No one else's. Unless the king had sent it to become someone else's, but that is coming from the king. It's his ownership. It sent a message of authority, too. No one had the right to do anything with that package other than the king. His authority was behind it. He got to say what was going to happen to it. Or if he's sending it to someone else, they could only do with it what he said had to be done with it. It was a sign of authority. And then I would have to say also, it was a sign of warning. What if you decided, king, so what? I'm cracking that flap and seeing what's on the inside. Well, that seal on that envelope should be sending you a very clear message that you are now in big trouble. Because that king has the authority to punish you in whatever way he wants to. That's what the seal says. And so the seal was like sending a message saying, this is mine. Don't touch it unless I've authorized you to. And if you regard my seal, I will use my authority to punish you accordingly. All right, that's what sealing looked like. So similarly, when we believed, when we trusted in Christ, as we talked about last week, the Father sealed us with the Holy Spirit. And he did it to send a very clear, strong message to everyone who sees it. Who? Well, what about all those beings out there who will try to mess with God's children? Try to affect the saints. Try to cause them harm. Try to keep us from our inheritance. Try to keep us from being fully redeemed. All of those beings, you say, beings? Who are you talking about? Well, we're talking about Satan, the dragon, in Sunday school this morning. And did you notice in Revelation chapter 12, when heaven announced the dragon, when heaven described the dragon, how did heaven describe the dragon? He is the one who has been accusing God's people day and night before the throne. What's that mean? It means Satan himself is going before God and saying, they should be convicted. Did you see what they just did? Did you hear what they just said? That's sin. They're not redeemed. They're not set apart from sin. They don't deserve any inheritance from you. They deserve to be condemned and punished. This is how Satan is spending his time, most all of his time, right now. And he's got legions of evil spirits, demons, who move around in this world unseen because they're spirit beings. And what is their role? Their role is to wreak havoc on God's people. Their role is to do whatever they can to cause God's people to fall so that God cannot give them what he's promised to them, so that God doesn't get the glory that he deserves from them. And these demons will use human beings to try to make that happen. Again, go back and look at the early New Testament church, Acts chapter 2 forward. And what was going on? Great persecution to these new believers. You had unbelieving Jews, like the Apostle Paul, Saul then, chasing new believers all over the planet to try to have them arrested or try to have them killed, to turn them away from God and not be the redeemed and not get this inheritance from God, all to destroy the glory of God and his Son, Jesus Christ. Because if they can keep us from God's promise, They can keep him from getting his rightful glory through us. But when those beings see the seal of God, when those beings see the Holy Spirit, they are seeing the authentic mark of God's ownership, God's authority, God's protection. They are hearing a very clear message from God that says, hands off, this one is mine. I've got big plans for him. You have no rights here. Do not trespass against him, or you will meet the full judgment of my authority. So you see what this sealing does? It's almost like God fencing us in to protect us from all on the outside who would try to stop the Father's blessings from coming to us. That's what sealing is. That's what the Father did for us when he gave us his Holy Spirit to seal us. He's protecting us from those outside beings who would try to harm us and cut us off from God's blessings. But it's not just God's message to those on the outside. Look at verse 14 with me. Paul goes on to describe the role of the Holy Spirit a little bit further. He says this, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession. Okay? So here's another part of the Holy Spirit's work, or the Father's work of sealing us through the Holy Spirit. This is a little different than what I've already talked about. So let me illustrate it this way. Probably most of you by this point have been involved in buying a house. Maybe it was 50 years ago for some of you. Maybe it was last year for some of you. And so the process has changed a little bit, but not dramatically. And so you remember, you understand how that whole process works, right? You find a house that you like, it's up for sale. And you go to the seller and you make an offer to the seller. You offer to purchase his house for a certain price, maybe $200,000. Don't you wish you could get a nice big house for $200,000 anymore? The seller accepts your offer and you write a contract with that seller that says, on such and such date, I will give you $200,000, and in return, you hand over the keys. The house becomes mine. But how will the seller be sure I'm going to show up with all that money on that date? How does he know I'm not just jerking him around? How does he know I'm not just trying to get him to take that house off the market because I just don't want anybody else to have it and I'm just spiteful? How does he know for sure I'm going to show up with what I've promised? Well, I give him what has been called down through the ages an earnest deposit. With the contract where I sign that I'm going to give him $200,000 on such and such date, I give him an earnest deposit. I may give him $10,000 of the $200,000. So I give him $10,000 up front, and I promise to bring the other $190,000 on that agreed-to date. And if I don't bring the other $190,000, what happens? He keeps the $10,000. It's his. And that earnest deposit that I've given to him is, it's like a token of my earnestness. It's the part of money now to assure him that the rest of that money is coming later. All right, there's the illustration. So spiritually, this is what Paul is describing that happens to the saints when the Father seals us with the Holy Spirit. When the Father sends the Holy Spirit of promise to seal us, it's like he's saying, I have promised you that you will be fully redeemed in the future, that you will get Christ in person as your inheritance forever. And as a token of my earnestness, as a sign of my seriousness, here's my earnest deposit up front. Here's part of the full package that I've promised later. Now, why would we need that earnest deposit from God? Why? Why would God need to do that to give us more confidence, to give us more assurance, or to give us reassurance that what he's promised, he will come through on in the future? Why do we need that from him? Well, I think partly, maybe mostly, is because if you're like me, you probably spend a good bit of your time every day watching yourself, which leads you tempted to think, there's no way I've been redeemed from sin. There's no way I'll ever be completely free from sin because look, I keep doing it. I did it yesterday. I just did it again. Some of the same things I keep doing over and over again. There is no way I have redemption or that I could ever be completely set free from sin. And there's no way the Father will bring me into the presence of His Son when I keep acting like this. When I'm in this condition, I am not fit for Christ, and there's no way the Father is going to give me such a great inheritance when I'm acting like this. You ever think that way? Ever feel that way? Ever tempted to go down that road? Yeah, probably so. So it's because of my failures and my doubts that I need something outside of myself to give me confidence that God will still bless me. Enter the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit of promise. God's earnest deposit to me. And it's like God is saying, if I'm giving you the Spirit who is one with the Son because of the unity of the Godhead, then it's like I'm already giving you the Son in part. So would you think I wouldn't give you Him in full as I have promised? Given you part already, surely I will give you the full inheritance of Christ in the future. And look at what the Spirit is doing for you, inside of you, indwelling you. Look at what He's doing for you. He's sanctifying you. The very fact that you are grieving over your sin is evidence of the Holy Spirit's work to break sin's hold on you. That's evidence of His work to purify you and make you fit for Christ. And on top of that, that longing that you have to be fit for Christ, that's the work of the Holy Spirit inside of you. That's Him working in your heart. That's Him helping you to see Christ's glory faintly now and to start enjoying Him to some degree already, even though it's from a distance now, as we wait to be with Him constantly in all His fullness in the future as the Father has promised. And so this is the blessing of the Father. This is the sealing work of the Holy Spirit. This is what the Father is doing for us through the Spirit to protect us from all of our enemies and the harm that they may try to do to us, trying to cut us off from all of God's blessings to us. This is the Holy Spirit even protecting us from our own worst enemy, from ourselves, by giving us reassurance and security in the promise and the work of God to fully redeem us and to bless us with Christ, who will be our inheritance for all of eternity. This is another blessing, just as great as the ones that came before it and those which will come after it. So, let me wrap this up with a couple of conclusions. The first is going to be a lot like one of them last week. First, let me talk to any of you who might be here this morning, who have listened, maybe you listened last week as well, but you've listened once again to another promised blessing from God, another work of God in the life and the heart of those that He has chosen before time. If you sit here this morning and you have really no confidence that all of these blessings have been given to you, if you aren't sure that you've been redeemed and adopted into God's family, if you sit here this morning and you look back to last week when we talked about trusting in Christ and what that really looks like, and you have to honestly admit that you haven't been trusting in Christ, but you want to. You want to be one of these saints. You want to have these blessings from the Father in Christ. Then ask the Father. Ask. Ask for the Holy Spirit. He's the one who can do all that you need to be done spiritually. He's the one that gives the faith that you desperately need. He's the one who will seal you for the complete redemption in the future. He's the one who will protect you for the inheritance of Christ that the Father has promised to all who trust in His Son. And the Father promises to give the Holy Spirit to those who sincerely desire Him and ask for him. So do it. Ask, believing the promises of God. And what about the rest of you? If you sit here this morning and you're pretty confident that all these blessings that we've been talking about are yours, you already are receiving them in whatever measure God wants you to have them right now, and whatever is still out in the future, you fully believe that that's going to be yours too. Because you see the evidence that the Holy Spirit is working in your life. You see faith. You see that gift. You are trusting in Jesus Christ. All of your confidence is in what Christ has already done in his life and his death to make you fit, to make you right before God. You see that evidence. Well, if that's you, I want to point out two things for you that I want you to notice before we wrap this up. Here's the first thing I want you to notice. From what we've seen this morning, did you notice the commitment behind all of the Father's blessings to you? We've been talking about redemption and the inheritance this morning. But did you notice the commitment that is behind or underneath all of these blessings? We've been talking for weeks and weeks and now about all that the Father planned for us before he ever created a thing. And all that the Father gave to us in Christ before we were ever even thought of in this life. We've been talking about all that Christ, the Son, did. All that he sacrificed. All that he suffered to secure all of these blessings for us. And now this morning, we are seeing the Holy Spirit, who is actively involved in this work of grace too. In a few weeks, as we move into Ephesians chapter 2, we're going to see that it's the Spirit who regenerates the saints. We probably could have pulled it into some of these blessings that we've already talked about, maybe faith last week. But Paul handles it distinctly and strongly, and he talks about the fact that we were spiritually dead. How does a dead person come to life? Only by the work of God through the Holy Spirit. He's the one who regenerates. It's the Spirit who grants the faith that is required for us to be justified. The faith through which we are saved. The faith that we need to be pleasing to God. It's the Holy Spirit that grants that faith. And here we see that it's the Spirit who makes sure we lose nothing that the Father has promised to us. That's how serious God is about what he's doing for us. You thought about that before? The entire Godhead is behind these blessings. Each person of the Trinity is all in. Individually, jointly, actively, constantly, for us to receive the blessings the Father has planned for us. This is an eternally coordinated and unified effort by the Trinity for us to be able to enjoy God in Christ forever and ever and ever. I wish this was the Psalms so we could get one of those little Selahs out to the end of it. I love those. Maybe when you read the Psalms and you see it, you just keep on booking it, and it's almost like it's not even part of what was inspired. I don't know why it's there. It's off to the side. It doesn't even really make much sense. It makes a ton of sense. It is the writer saying, you need to stop right now. Stop right here and consider what has just been said. And I wish we could stick one in right here. You stop and consider that the entire Godhead, each person of the Trinity, has been eternally and constantly and actively involved in making sure you get God's blessings in Christ for all of eternity. You get to experience the joy of having and being with and enjoying Christ in all his fullness forever and ever and ever with nothing disturbing that. Each person of the Godhead has been working to make sure that happens, and it will happen. And it leaves us asking a question, at least me, what does a commitment like that from the entire Godhead to give us all of those blessings, what does that deserve from us? That should always be our question, right? What does it deserve? What does he deserve for all of that commitment? Well, this is the second thing that I want to point out to you. I want you to look back with me very quickly at three verses. Go back to verse 6. Notice the similarity of what I'm going to read to you, or the common thread in all three places. Verse 6, to the praise of the glory of His grace. Go down to verse 12. That we who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of His glory. Then look at the end of verse 14. I stopped here a little bit ago. The Holy Spirit is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession, to the praise of His glory. And that leads to the second observation, or the second thing I want you to notice. If you are a saint, if you are one of these people to whom all of these blessings have been and will be given, did you notice the purpose behind all of those blessings? All of the choices, all the plans, all the work of the Godhead are for one result. What is it? Praise. Period. It's the only word we need. Praise. All of it is being done for the constant, eternal praise from the saints to the Father and the Son for all that they are and for all that they've done for us. That's the ultimate end. That's the goal. It's not the finish line. Really, it's where it all begins. But that's why God is doing all that He's doing for His people. But even more, I want you to notice the word that Paul used all three places. Did you see it? It's the glory of God. Praise for the glory of God. Praise for the glory of His grace. It's also that Father and Son will receive praise for the glory of what they've done to bless us. And that word glory is so important. If Paul had left it out, it would change the interpretation a little bit. It would change the impact that it has on us. But he didn't leave it out. He put it in on purpose because the Holy Spirit wanted it there. Glory puts the work of the Godhead on a whole nother level. Glory points out how different that work is. Glory points out how special that work is. Adding the word glory here tells us that there is nothing normal or typical or average about the blessings of God. Glory screams, this word screams, look at the transcendence here. Look at the wonder, look at the brilliance, look at the awesomeness of God's blessings. The word glory is what shows up at Mount Sinai when Israel was the foot of the mountain and God came down on the mountain and they didn't see God, but what did they see? They saw the glory of God and it blew them away. The people were never again like they were at the foot of Mount Sinai when they saw the glory of God. Glory is what Peter, James, and John saw up on that other mountain when Jesus was transfigured before their eyes. They didn't know what to do with it. Peter's freaking out and coming up with all kinds of weird ideas, but we understand why. Because of what he saw. This is not normal. There's nothing typical about this. We've never seen anything like this before. It was mind-boggling. It affected him that much. Glory is what those poor soldiers at the tomb of Jesus Christ saw when the angel descended at the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And they're there watching, and they ended up paralyzed with fear. It's the glory of God that caused that. Seeing the glory of God in His grace is seeing how incredible He is in what He did for us. And when you think about it on a personal level, the glory of God's grace to you, and that we are to be praising God for the glory of that grace, it's the fact that the Father would send the Holy Spirit to stay with me and to protect me from all outside enemies and to reassure me that all the Father's promises will be mine when I still am what I am. How could I ever expect that? Who would do something so unbelievable for me? Who would go so far to give me so much? That's not just grace. It's not just a gift. It's not just a blessing from God. It's glorious grace. It is spectacular grace. It is unparalleled grace. It's what you're hearing When you sing that all-familiar song written by John Newton, "Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me." Why didn't John Newton just write, "Grace, how sweet the sound"? It's because he understood that what had been given to him is not normal. It's not ordinary. And through his music, he's trying to make it known how brilliant and spectacular and unexpected and radical this gift of salvation is that was given to him. The glory of God and His grace drove Charles Wesley to write that song we know so well. And can it be? How can it be that God would do all of this to bless me? Both of those men saw the glory of God in His blessings, and they tried to praise Him as He deserves with their music. So should we be any different? If we will one day fully, constantly, be praising God for the glory of those blessings He's given to us, then shouldn't we be living now with sort of an already, not yet mindset? No, we're not yet there praising God in His presence for His glory, the glory of His grace and all these blessings to us. We're not there yet. But we can already be starting to do it here. And we should be. And we will be if the Spirit is in us. Let me make a statement, and I want you to remember this. The heart will glorify God to the extent that it sees glory in God. Think that through. The heart will glorify God to the extent that it sees glory in God. And frankly, the truth of that statement worries me a bit. Because there are so many people who profess to be Christians, and they claim to believe in God, but they act like they see nothing glorious in God. John Owen wrote about this many, many years ago, and he said it this way: "The pretended desires of many to behold the glory of Christ in heaven, who have no view of it by faith while they are in this world, are nothing but self-deceiving imaginations." You can talk about being with God and Christ in heaven for all of eternity, but if you're not seeing any of their glory now, it's just an imagination. You're just deceiving yourself with that possibility. A heart not genuinely praising God for His glory must see no glory in God. But a heart that is trying, failing a lot, but lamenting its failing, and trying harder to praise God for His glory, must be seeing that glory and longing to give Him the praise that He deserves for it. So where are you? You can't answer for me, I can't answer for you. You can't look into my heart, I can't look into yours. But where are you? Do you see the evidence that the Holy Spirit is sealing you? That He is protecting you from all outside enemies, that He is protecting you from yourself and your own doubts, that the Holy Spirit is keeping your focus on the great promises and glorious work of God for you in Christ? Is that you? You see the evidence of it? Be honest before God. Go to Him for what you need. If you're listening and you're seeing that you're coming up lacking, that you're not seeing this stuff that we're talking about, go to God for what you need. And then give Him the praise He deserves for the glory of what He gives you in Christ. And may we as a group be known for just what we've seen this morning: the Father's work for us and the Father's work in us to get genuine praise from us now and for all of eternity. May that be the way people know Rosemont Baptist Church. Let's pray. Father, the things we've talked about this morning are the things only You can do. On behalf of those in this room, to whom, for whom You have done them, wow, I praise You for the glory of what You've done. And whenever I say that, I always feel like I'm coming up short. I always feel like there are no words big enough and broad enough and deep enough to really give you the praise and the honor and the recognition that you deserve. But I try. We try. As we look at these blessings, and they boggle our mind that you would do such things, starting before anything was ever created and continuing for all of eternity, knowing ourselves that you would do that for us, not just promising it, but carrying it out at the cost involved, the ransom of Jesus Christ, the death of the Son of God as a man to give us these blessings. Praise be to God. Praise for your glory. Praise for the glory of your grace. And Father, as we leave here this morning, I pray that this truth about your grace will go with us and stick in our minds and our hearts so that we can't forget about it. We have to keep talking about it and talking about you so that we continue to praise you. It comes out in our words. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. That will come out in our prayers. That will come out in our songs. That will be the subject of conversation between us. That will be how we are bragging on you to people we meet on the street tomorrow. Father, that it will affect our actions as well. Because the God who would give us such glorious grace deserves so much from us. As we'll see in chapter 4, where Paul says, "Now walk worthy of the calling with which you've been called. Try to live in a way that matches what's been given to us." That's what we want. So, Father, I pray that your Spirit will help us with that this week. And Father, lastly, I pray for any who might be with us this morning who are confused, they're frustrated, maybe they're a little worried, maybe they're a little scared, but they have a desire. There's this longing inside to have what we've been talking about. To be in this kind of a relationship with you where they are promised your blessings. They want to see change. They want to be able to believe. They never have, but they want to be able to believe. Well, Father, I pray that you will grant them faith through your Holy Spirit. I pray that you will bring them to life, if you haven't already, that you will bring them to life from spiritual death to spiritual life. Draw them to Jesus Christ as only you can do, for his glory and for their joy. And Father, for all that you do, we will make sure that you get the credit for it. We pray it all in Christ's name. Amen.